I don't get this guy. He claims he's never stepped foot in a room. How can anyone be a true follower of Jesus Christ if he goes to the movies? Doesn't he know we've been called to separate ourselves from that sort of filth? If that guy has a bigger opinion about freedom, doesn't he realize that many movies and fiction are quite worthwhile? I think even Jesus promises some of them. I just don't get it. We're called to be separate. We're called to demonstrate to the watching world that we live differently because we follow Jesus. I just don't get it. If there's a movie that sensitizes us to the brokenness of this world, or even helps us see the world the way God really wants to see it, why wouldn't we want to see it? Forget that guy. He's obviously got it all wrong. I am no use for him.
Spoken, but somebody at the planning team says, I love Christmas, but what I really can't wait for kill himself in the atmosphere. And it reaches its climax when somebody says, well, you like tulips, I like crocuses, I can't work with you anymore. I am out of here. Right now there's some blood soak, and it's a bit extreme, but this is something in the spirit that Paul is addressing in our passage this morning. There's been a debate that's arisen within the church in Rome. They're all on the same team. They recognize that they're all part of this kingdom of God. And yet there are factions that are separating themselves from each other, pointing fingers at each other over the matter of what can we eat as a family. To a lesser degree, what can we drink? And maybe even to a lesser degree, which days are we supposed to honor as sacred? But maybe what has to do with what can we eat? And to those who are saying, we must not eat meat, we got to recognize that these traditionalists are not just coming out of nowhere. We remember that in the Mosaic Law and our Old Testament that Moses had given these commands about what you could eat and what you could not eat. So we might call these on the one side, we'll say we will not eat meat, and we call them the traditionalists. And the traditionalists are saying, out of obedience to God, out of respect for what God has revealed to us, we must not eat meat, and we keep the meat that you do. That's what they're saying. And others are saying, oh, wait a minute, those laws have been abrogated, they've been set aside. We have good authority. Jesus put us in the stretch, and we can't eat this meat. So who are you to say we can? And they both start pulling fingers at each other, saying, how could you hold your name? Now, I sympathize with the traditionalists just for a moment. I recall that in our own denomination, we had this little thing about worldly amusements in 1928, and it said Christian Reformed Church members are not allowed to attend the movie theaters or play cards or, of course, dance. In 1966, in a gathering, said, well, let's rethink about this. Actually, we discern that if we engage with these children, it is permissible to attend the mass theater. It is permissible to play cards. It is permissible even to dance. I suspect that if you lived through that, there were plenty of people who said, we are so grateful for Synod's ruling on this. We're grateful for our new tradition. We will engage in it with gratitude and with discernment. And I suspect that there were others who said, I don't stuff on every single occasion for commitment. Here's a community that actually grows in its unity, increasingly so, and never finds that unity to be suffered. Here's a community that is constantly building up, but it is never in the community that never gets sick of each other, always finds that coming together to be a beautiful and joyous occasion. Here's a community that it still deals with conflicts with which it finds that each new conflict or tension is resolved in a quicker manner because we're learning increasingly how to walk consistently in this path of things. Here's a community that is increasingly doing its instinctively what is right and good because we're being transformed by the Holy Spirit to do this righteousness that God wants to do. And currently, we have fewer and fewer reasons to do the conflict in front of you and to walk away from each other. This is what Paul wants to talk about. Paul knows that in any given area, there can be any number of issues that cause the people of God to come together and to focus squarely on the matters of the difference. Paul says, there's a place to do it without reaching for this. Pursue peace. Make every effort straight for it. But also be concerned about the mutual edification. We can only a couple of things that the reason Paul and I must do this is this is that as we come together, mutual edification leads to it and an outward posture. The community of hope, not truly not just for itself, but for the world. Paul knows that coming together as followers of Jesus Christ could potentially result in two things that it could come together to simply quarrel over these matters of indifference, what's peaceful and what's not. Paul says, don't make your commitment together about that. Come together to be with each other about that. To enjoy the peace and the joy that comes with it. And come together in such a way that we're attentive to the growth of each individual so that as we turn our focus outward, the world comes to see that there is truly a community that is concerned with the world. And it gives us the opportunities to pursue the questions that the world needs to find resolved in so many ways. Paul has an idea of community of people committed to living as followers of Jesus Christ, pursuing righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit, building each other up so that as we face the issues of the day, we can face some of the risks of unity and resolve and wisdom and care. So how do we respond to problems that continue to face our life? How do we as God's people respond to something for this? How do we as God's people respond to a crisis in the world that has to do with what we do? How do we as God's people give witness to the fact that there's hope? And that there's hope. And it's possible because of what God has done through Jesus Christ and because of the work of the Spirit that is ongoing in our lives. Almost out of that, every is an opportunity to come together to focus on matters of the difference. I would say so through those cards and so through those patient cards. But when you come together, let your focus be on righteousness. Let your focus be on peace. Let your focus be on joy. So that you provide hope to this world. And we're on to something